In the previous lecture, we have tested the register API service through Postman and we are able to successfully register a new user. Inside this lecture, let's try to test notices API that we have, both with the Postman and the Angular UI client. In the process, we are going to face a problem and we can talk more about it. And to solve this problem, we can take help from the Spring security. So in order to test the notices API, we just have to make sure what is our REST API path. It is slash notices and it is supporting HTTP GET method. So my server is running. I can test first through Postman. So inside my Postman, you can see I'm trying to invoke this API, which is HTTP localhost 8080 slash notices. And we are invoking this as an HTTP GET method. So if I try to click on this send, since it does not require any authentication, I am getting a proper response with all the active notices that I have inside the database. So total, I have 6 active notices and all of them are being displayed on my Postman response. So now let's try to test the same through the Angular UI application. So this is my Angular UI application. And as soon as I click on the notices, I should get a response from my backend and the notices details needs to be displayed on my Angular application. Let me show you how the flow will be to the backend so that you are clear how the communication between client and the backend server is going to happen. All these home, login, contact us, notices are present inside the header HTML. So let me go to the header HTML. So if I open this header component.html, whatever tabs that you are able to see on the header right now, they are displayed because we are not authenticated. So whenever we not authenticated, home, login, contact us and notices will be displayed. So if someone click on this notices, I am telling to the Angular app, please redirect the user to the router link slash notices. So where are this routing information we configured? We have configured all these routing details inside this app routing.module.ts. So let me open this. So inside this for notices path, we are telling to go and invoke the logic present inside the notices component. So inside notices component, we are telling whenever someone is trying to land on this notices component during the initialization of the component, I'm trying to invoke the get notice details function available inside the dashboard service. And since it is going to invoke a REST API in the backend, I'm trying to subscribe that. And if I get a response, the same I'm setting into the notices array that I have inside this notices component class. So this notices object, again, if you go and check my HTML page of this notices page, inside this, if you can see, I'm using ngfer. So ngfer inside Angular, we can use to iterate the list of elements inside an array. So this is the model object that I have, which is notices. So whenever I say let notice of notices, I'm trying to iterate each element by element. So for all the elements, whatever code I have written inside this div will be executed. And from each of this notice object, we are going to fetch the notice summary and notice details, and the same will be displayed on the UI page. And if you can go back to the notices.component.ts, so here if you click on this get notice details, which is available inside the dashboard service, so it is going to make a HTTP GET request to the root URL, which is localhost 8080. So this is looking good. And the path is slash notices. So this is also looking good. And with the observe as response, we're telling we want everything, not only header or not only the body, we want entire response. And if you can check inside the component, we are extracting the body from the response object that we received from the backend server. And we are not mentioning anything with credentials is equal to true. The reason is this is an public API. My Spring security framework does not expect any security cookies or details or credentials or session ID details from the front end application. So that's why we don't need to mention this with credentials as true. Now everything is looking good and there is no mistake that we have done inside the UI. And we also tested the backend notices API with the Postman and it is also working perfectly. So with that confidence, we are expecting some response to be displayed on our notices page. So let's hope for the best. I'm clicking on this notices. And before that, I'll try to open the developer console. So now you can see the console is clean. So I'm trying to click on this notices. You are going to have a surprise here. Boom. So you can see there is an error saying that the communication between origins like localhost 4200, which is a client application, with the backend application, which is hosted at the port 8080, has been blocked by the CARS policy, which means The communication between an UI application and the backend application is not happening. Even if you check the console of the backend application, there is no exception. That means the invocation never came to the backend application and it is failing in the browser level itself. So what is happening? We have not done any mistake here. Everything is perfect on the UI side and everything is perfect on the backend side. So this is because due to the CARS policy that we have inside the modern browsers. So let's try to understand what is this CARS in the next lecture so that we can take help from Spring Security and fix this issue and establish the communication between our UI client and the backend server. Thank you and I'll catch you in the next lecture. Bye. As of now, inside this course, we discussed a lot about authentication. We have secured our web application by enforcing security and authentication so that only authenticated users can access my web application. Now, inside this section, we are going to focus on authorization as well. I know you may have some questions like, what is the difference between authentication and authorization? I see many times inside the projects, developers and testers, they use this authentication and authorization without knowing the differences between them. So that's why inside this lecture, let's focus on understanding what is the difference between authentication and authorization. If you ask me what is the definition of authentication, as part of authentication, we'll try to identify who is the user trying to access our web application. Without the authentication, we cannot make any person or any end user to access our secured APIs. Whereas authorization will come into picture once the successful authentication is completed. As part of authorization, we'll be checking what are the authorities or privileges or roles a particular end user has. Accordingly, we are going to build the business logic inside our web application so that he can access various scenarios or various functionalities inside our web application based upon his privileges. If you take any bank application, there'll be many roles involved like clerk, cashier, manager, supervisor. So there are many roles involved and every role will have their own authorities or privileges. So that kind of enforcing the end user's access inside our system based upon their privileges, we call it as authorization. That is the very first definition and basic difference between the authentication and authorization. Coming to the second difference, authentication, which in short form we call it as auth capital N, will always come before the authorization. Whereas authorization, which we can in short form call it as auth Z, always happens after the authentication. There will be never a scenario where we are performing authorization without authentication. We always first ask end user to log in into our system. Post that only, we will worry about his privileges, access levels and roles. Accordingly, we can enforce the authorization. Coming to the third difference, in order to perform authentication, we'll only ask the user login details. What is your email or what is your mobile number and what are your credentials or OTP? So all these details we collect from the end user to achieve a successful authentication of end user into my web application. Whereas inside authorization, we'll never worry about the user credentials. We only worry about his authorities or privileges or roles. Based upon these authorities, roles and privileges only, we decide his access level inside our web application. Moving on to the next difference, whenever the authentication fails, we get an error code 401, which means the authentication is failed. Whereas in the scenario of authorization, we get an error code 403. So whenever we are getting 403 means the authentication is successful, but this user is not authorized to access so and so functionality. That's why we get 403, which is a forbidden error whenever the authorization fails. And at last, if you ask me real-time examples to talk about authentication and authorization, like I said, you can always take a bank application. So inside a bank application, we can have various roles like customer, admin, cashier, bank manager, supervisor. So these are all the roles involved. For all these users, we first inside our bank application, we'll always ask their credentials to prove their identity. So that's a part of authentication inside any bank application. Once the end user is authenticated and logged into my application, then based upon his roles, privileges, and authorities, the functionality that he can access or the pages that he can see on the web application will be different from one user to another user. If you are still not clear about authentication and authorization, I can also give an real life example. Think of a scenario. You have decided to fly from New York to London. In order to fly from New York to London, you'll book a ticket, you'll go to the airport. At the entrance of the airport, the security guys, they'll ask you to prove your identity. Who are you? So that's where you will show your passport, your ticket details. Once that authentication is successful, you can enter into the airport. The security guy will never worry about where you are going to roam inside the airport. It's not his job. His job is only to perform the authentication based upon your identity details. Once you enter into the airport, you can only enter into the flight which is flying from the New York to London. If you decided at the last minute, I want to fly from New York to Singapore, then that is not possible because based upon your ticket ID details, you are only authorized to fly from the New York to London. So that scenario is like you have role or privilege or authority to travel in a particular flight, but not in any of the flights. So that's one of the real life example I can imagine. I hope now you are clear with what is the difference between authentication and authorization. In all the previous sections, we simply focused on authentication. And whenever the authentication is successful, we are simply giving all access to my end user. He can navigate to any page. He can check any functionality inside our web application. Now, inside this section, we are going to focus on how to implement or enforce authorization inside our web application. With that, let's jump into the journey of authorization from the next lecture. Thank you and bye. Inside this lecture, as I said, I'm going to show you what are the inbuilt filters that are being used by the Spring Security Framework whenever we try to authenticate an user inside our web application. In order to see all these filters inside our logs or inside our console, we need to make two changes inside our web application. The very first one is, inside your Spring Boot application main class, you need to mention an annotation which is @enable web security. To this annotation, you need to pass the settings debug == true. And the second change that you have to do is, inside your application.properties, you need to enable the debug logging for a class called filter chain proxy. This filter chain proxy class has all the logic of chaining the inbuilt filters of Spring Security, which I am going to show you in few seconds. But please do not these changes inside your production web application, because if you do these changes along with the internal filter details, it is also going to log the sensitive information of your end user, like his session ID, which is like very dangerous inside production web application. It is going to create a lot of security breaches. That's why please do not this. I have highlighted here also inside the slide. Just for our understanding purpose, I'm going to make these changes inside our web application. In order to work on the filter related changes inside this section, we need to create a new Maven project which is specific to section 8. So that's why I'm going to copy this previous section project and paste it inside the same folder and rename the project name to Spring Security Section 8. Inside this, we can delete the content of the target folder, and post that we can open the pom.xml. Inside this pom.xml, we can change the artifact ID and the name to the Spring Security Section 8. I'm saving these changes and closing this pom.xml. With that, now we can import this new project into our IntelliJ ID. So in order to import, I'm going to select the option File, New, Module from Existing Sources, and I'm going to select the pom.xml present inside the Spring Security Section 8. So I'm selecting the same. This will import this Maven project into my workspace. As a next step, I'm going to reload all Maven projects so that all the dependencies will be downloaded. Once all the dependencies are downloaded, we can try to build this module by right-clicking on this and selecting this Build Module Spring Security Section 8. So this will build my project and there are no compilation issues, which is good. Now we can go to the Spring Boot main class inside this project, and the main class name is Easy Bank Backend Application. So on top of this class, we are going to mention an annotation which is Enable Web Security, and to this annotation we are going to pass the configurations which is debug == true. By default it is false, so we are going to enable it. So this is one of the changes that we need to do. And the second change that we need to do inside this project is, we need to go to the application.properties, and inside this application.properties we need to define a new property which will enable the debug logging of the class filter chain proxy, which is available inside the Spring Security Framework. So let's try to see what is there inside this filter chain proxy. For the same, I'm opening this, and this is present inside the Spring Security Framework, and this is a class. And inside this class, you can search for an inner class with the name virtual filter chain. So this is a virtual filter chain that will be maintained by the Spring Security Framework. If you see inside this filter, there's a method called doFilter. And inside this method, there is a logic of iterating over all the filters available inside my Spring Security filter chain. So you can see here, it will track what is the current position. If the current position is equal to the total size of the filters, it is not going to invoke the next filter. Instead, it is going to call the original chain.doFilter. Otherwise, it is going to take what is the next filter available inside the chain. And using this next filter, it is going to invoke the method doFilter. This way, my Spring Security Framework is going to iterate all the activated internal filters one by one so that all the logic inside them will be executed. What we can do is, we can put a breakpoint inside this so that we can see that filter chain in live. So with these changes, we should be good. Let me do a build here. Once the build is completed, I can go to the Spring Boot main class, which is Easy Bank backend application, and I'm going to start in a debug mode. Now my backend server is started successfully. If you can open the debug console here, you can see a message saying that security debugging is enabled. This may include sensitive information do not use in a production system. So this is what I was highlighting in the previous lecture. Please do not do these settings inside production web applications. I can clean the console here so that it will be clear when we try to analyze the future logs. Now I will try to log in into my application. So the email that I'm going to give here is happyattherateexample.com and the password is 12345. As soon as I click sign in, you can see the breakpoint stopped inside my virtual filter chain available inside the filter chain proxy. Here, right now you can see the total size of my filters is 17, which means my Spring Security Framework is going to execute around 17 filters. And what is the current position? So the current position is 0, and that's why it will not go inside this if block. If you try to execute these lines one by one, we can see the internal filters that Spring Security has. You can see here, if you try to open this additional filters list, these are all the filters that are going to be executed by my Spring Security Framework. And every filter, it is going to iterate one by one by invoking the do filter method available inside each of these filters. So let me release this breakpoint. And since it is going to stop 17 times, we can remove this breakpoint. Now, if you go and check the console, here inside the console, you can see this is the sensitive information that my Spring Security is logging. So it is logging the authorization header along with the base64 encoded value of my username and password. So that's why this is not recommended to enable inside the production web applications. Now, if you scroll down, you can see these are all the internal Spring Security filters that got executed during the authentication of the end user. So this confirms that there are good amount of internal filters of Spring Security which are playing a critical role during the authentication, and each of them will have their own roles and responsibilities. I hope this is clear to you. From the next lecture, we are going to explore the options of how to define our own custom filter. And once we define custom filter, we can try to inject that into this security filter chain so that we can execute our own custom logic based upon our requirements. I hope this is all clear to you. Thank you, and I'll catch you in the next lecture. Bye.